All right. So last time we talked a lot about the factory label method. We talked about problem solving and all that fun stuff. Today we're going to go into chapter two. Someone is pounding on my door. No idea who it is, but I'm busy. So, last time we forgot to talk about density. And I want to talk a little bit about density. And the reality is, we don't really need to talk about it because if you know the factor label method, you don't have to memorize the equation. The equation is pretty simple. Density is mass over volume. Maybe I should write this out. Density basically says how much volume a certain amount of matter occupies, or how much a certain volume of matter weighs. Used to be an old joke. What weighs more, a pound of water or a pound of feathers? Well, the purpose of the joke is to point out that they both weigh a pound. But it sounds a little bit odd because we know that the pound of feathers will take a much larger volume because the density of feathers is much smaller. The density of water by, well, density changes by temperature, but the density of water is usually taken to be 1 gram per milliliter. And keep in mind, when you write something like this with a sideways slash, this is the equivalent of saying 1 gram per milliliter. But just like any other conversion factor, you can use factor label with this because you can flip these. So 1 milliliter also weighs 1 gram. Mercury is kind of an interesting thing. The atomic symbol for mercury is capital H, lowercase g. Like I say, every element is on the periodic table. If it's a single letter, then it's a capitalized letter. If it's two letters, then it's a capital letter with a lowercase letter. Mercury has a density of 13.5 gram per milliliter. It's an interesting substance, it's a liquid. We used to have a small jar of mercury. Back in at DSU, we used to have a small jar of mercury by Ebing. And it's not like it was really heavy. It's not like you couldn't pick it up. It's not like you would struggle to pick it up. But the interesting thing is, it had roughly this, actually had a little less liquid than this in it. But the funny thing is, when you actually lifted that jar, it was amazing how heavy it actually was. You were shocked to find how heavy that liquid was because it just didn't look like that much. It was just a little bit. Now, specific gravity. And this is the main reason I wanted to bring this up is because of specific gravity. If I never mention density in here, you would be able to solve any mathematical problem you need with it because it's just factor label, grams and milliliters. Specific gravity is defined as the density of the material divided by the density of water. So specific gravity is gravity specifically as a ratio with water. Now, the density of water is 1 gram per milliliter. So the specific gravity does not change. The specific gravity is the same as the density, but why do we do it? And this is what I wanted to mention. Specific gravity drives me crazy. I hate specific gravity. And we're going to come up with it again when we talk about specific heat. I do not like specific gravity. I do not like it, Sam, I am. Because what the specific gravity does so density of, in this case, mercury divided by the density of water. Well, what's 13 divided by 1? I'm sorry, 13.5. Well, 13.5 divided by 1 is 13.5. So, how is specific gravity different than density? Well, specific gravity, as you re well, I'm sorry, as you recall from factor label, units cancel algebraically, which means these units in the numerator cancel with these units in the denominator. Specific gravity, just like specific heat, we will discover specific gravity is a unitless number. People do it because they are too lazy. They use specific gravity because they don't want to take the time to write the units. So they call it specific gravity. I don't like specific gravity because it cannot be used in factor label. I cannot take this number and set up unit analysis with it. That's why I don't like it. So, the only reason I mention it today, if you happen to see specific gravity, add the units gram per milliliter. Then it becomes density, and then you can use it in the factor label. Any questions about specific gravity before we move on? Okay. Ooh, I'm glad I did that. So last time we did not get to compounds. So let's talk a little bit about compounds. As you recall from Dalton's atomic theory, by definition, a compound is anything that, well, I'm sorry, distracted. A compound is something that is combined. Any questions? A compound is comprised, and here are the two key components. A compound is comprised of two or more different elements in a fixed whole number ratio. What are you drinking there, Kim?
Coffee.
Coffee. Coffee has caffeine. It has, actually, I don't know all the chemicals. It has the chemicals in it that make up the flavor of the coffee. It has the chemicals that make the color of the coffee. In the smell of coffee, there are over 100 different compounds. But those compounds, do you like your coffee strong or weak?
I like mine light with froth cream in it.
I agree. I'm not a fan of coffee. It's too bitter. So I make mine very, very weak with lots of cream, lots of sugar. I have friends who adore coffee and they make it extremely strong. But as you're doing that, you are varying the components. You're varying the different compounds that are in there in their concentration. The stronger the coffee, the higher the concentration. So those ratios of compounds are not fixed. That makes it a solution as opposed to a compound. This is why coffee is not a compound. We call it a solution. So, in a compound, you must have a fixed ratio. If you change the ratio, you change the compound. So, every element is on the periodic chart. Most people know that already. And if we have a compound, the most obvious compound, the easiest compound to do this with is water. H2O. H2O contains two elements. What are the two elements? What do you suppose H is?
Oxygen in it.
O is oxygen, H
Yep.
is hydrogen.
Hydrogen.
Okay. The ratio of hydrogen to oxygen is 2 to 1. And it's fixed. I saw a bottle of water at a convenience store at one point that said it was extra refreshing because they removed half of the hydrogen. We can't do that. Change the formula, you change the ratio, you change the compound. If there is no number, one is assumed. So there's one oxygen, we don't bother to write the one. When there is a number in a compound, it's always lowercase following, I'm sorry, it's always subscripted after the element, H. Subscript 2O. Any element that is not in the compound, we don't bother to write. So there's no aluminum in water. Now, not to say that you can't have aluminum dissolved in your water, you can have a solution. But H2O tells us there's two hydrogens, one oxygen, no other elements. But if you change the ratio, you change the compound. This is a real compound. You have to know what this particular compound is.
No.
This is hydrogen peroxide, H2O2. The ratio here is 2 to 2, and you might say, oh, but I can reduce that to 1 to 1. Now, in chemistry, we're going to talk a little bit about why sometimes we do that and sometimes we don't. When we do not reduce it, it tells us something about the compounds, and we'll talk about that in a later chapter. Water sustains life. With the exception of viruses, every living thing on Earth requires water to live. Everything. Hydrogen peroxide kills things. That's why we use it as an antiseptic. It kills things. When you put it on your skin, it is so deadly that your body has developed special enzymes just to break down peroxides. They kill things. When you use peroxide on a cut, you are killing your own skin. We're hoping it kills more germs, more microbes than it does skin cells, but it does kill. That's why we use it. Hydrogen peroxide, when you get it in the grocery store, if it's fresh, it is 2%. And it does decompose over time. So old hydrogen peroxide is not as strong. In the chemistry lab, the highest percentage hydrogen peroxide that you can get is about 20% hydrogen peroxide. If a drop of hydrogen peroxide, if just a tiny little droplet splashes onto your skin, it kills your skin like that. You get dead white spots of dead white skin. Because it just kills it. And the difference between hydrogen peroxide and water, the ratio of oxygen to hydrogen. That is the only difference. So, compounds. Two or more different elements. Remember, the same element, like O2 versus O3, those aren't compounds because it's just oxygen, the different forms of the element. And we call those allotropes. Allotropes are different forms of an element. Element. Seem to have a chat going on here. All right. So thank you for your comment, Kim. What I don't understand is why the font on my chat is so large that I can't read entire words. Anyway, all right. So any questions about that before we move on?
Nope.
Let's go back to Dalton's atomic theory. Come on. Ooh, there we go. We're going to spend pretty much the rest of this course talking about part four. Talking about compounds, different types of compounds, reactions of compounds. Actually, we're going to talk about elements too, and all that fun stuff. And I told you this. Some parts of Dalton's atomic theory are absolutely, to the best of our knowledge, absolutely true. Some parts of it are excellent assumptions, but not quite true. Let's talk about, for example, part one. All matter is comprised of indestructible particles called atoms. And let's talk about the indestructible part. Turns out atoms are not indestructible. Back in the 19th century, most of the research we're going to talk about today was done around 1900, give or take 10, 15, 20 years. Madame Curie was the first scientist, not the first woman, but the first scientist to win the Nobel Prize, not in one, but two different scientific disciplines. Today, that feat has been matched, if I'm not mistaken, by only one other person. She won her Nobel Prizes in chemistry and in physics. And this, she did around the time that women were, they weren't important. They were ornamental. Women were supposed to wear long petticoats and stay in the kitchen and have babies and cook and clean. And that was their job. They had no purpose. And yet here's this scientist. The scientist who won the Nobel Prize in two different disciplines. And for the love of God, she was a woman. Her husband, Pierre Curie, probably would have won the Nobel Prize with her. Turns out Pierre died in a, not because of radiation, but because of a carriage accident. Crossing the street, he got run over by a carriage and was killed. And they do not give Nobel Prizes posthumously. That's why Pierre never won the Nobel Prize. But here's this man who's so loved and so respected his wife that he had the nerve, he had the audacity to actually invite him into his lab to work. He actually worked with her on science. How crazy is that, to work with a woman? Oh my God. And to make matters worse, he would bring this female, would bring this woman with him to scientific meetings. How crazy is that? Why isn't she home cooking? Take away her shoes, man. And when other scientists had questions about his work, he would say, actually, my wife is the expert. You should go ask her. And they did. And she could answer. And when her husband died, she kept going to those scientific meetings. And by that time, she had earned the respect of her fellow scientists so much that they, well, not only kept asking her questions, but they honored her with the Nobel Prize, not once, but twice. It makes you wonder, how much have we given up in knowledge, in progress, in technology? How much have we lost? How much further would we have advanced if we hadn't discarded people because they had the wrong gender or the wrong skin color or their God had the wrong name? It's something worth considering. Madame Curie discovered and isolated radium. Atomic symbol Ra. Radium. Radium is, that's why I'm hearing knocking. Actually, they're working on my roof. Radium is an element that is not only indestructible, but it is so weak that it falls apart on its own. It just falls apart. So radiochemists and physicists and all kinds of weird people didn't set up an experimental apparatus. They would have a lead block that they could put their radioactive sample in. And as radiation fell apart, it was giving off subatomic particles. And they put in a lens system. And the lens would allow them to focus a beam of these subatomic particles. Then they would pass it through some electrical plates. Now the plates, they could vary the charge on. So you'd have your cathode with its positive charge on one side. And your anode on the other side. Then they could turn the voltage up and down, whatever they wanted. And they would put a screen coated with phosphorus. So when the particle struck the beam, struck the phosphorus, it would glow. And they would wrap the entire thing in a vacuum tube. Because these particles are so light. Boy, I draw that vacuum tube poorly. These particles are so light that air will deflect them. So they had to have it in a vacuum tube. As the particles flowed through these charged plates, some of them would be deflected slightly towards the anode. And they would get a glow here. Oh, and sometimes they put something in between the source, you know, I mean, they were putting little things in there that like metal, so they could see what radiation would pass through, what would not, yada, 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 all that fun stuff. But if it was attracted to the negative plate and repelled by the positive, that means that this particle is heavy. It's heavy because it was not deflected much. And it had a positive charge. So something inside the atom has a positive charge. It's a positive charge. Let's call it, I don't know. Let's call it the proton. Proton is given the symbol lowercase p. They didn't know the exact charge, so they just said, it's a charge of plus one. We'll call it plus one. And its mass, we don't know its mass. We'll say it has a mass of one. And they called it one atomic mass unit. Today we know exactly what that charge is, and we know exactly what that mass is. Back then, they didn't know. They just Well, one is easiest. Let's use one. Well, if something is positively charged, it only makes sense because the world is electrically neutral. The entire universe is electrically neutral. So if something is positively charged, there has to be something negatively charged. But they were shocked because this negative charge particle deflected a lot. Huge deflection, which means that it was very light. Negatively charged. I used to love old chemistry textbooks because I've always been curious how old chemists understood and how they figured things out even before they knew what the hell the subatomic particles were. I had this marvelous textbook that I had to give up when I gave up my library, which broke my heart. That said, it actually had a little paragraph in there that said, "We have just discovered a brand new subatomic particle that we are tentatively calling the electron." And yet, they figured out atomic theory. They figured out charges. They called them valencies back then. They figured out the ratios of elements. They figured it all out. And how they did that was just fascinating to me. But this light negative element, particle, not element, particle, let's call it the electron. Yeah, that's a good name. We haven't used that word yet. The electron. It has the same charge as the proton, but negative. So the same magnitude of charge, but it is negative. And relative to the mass of the proton, they said it has a mass of zero. It has no mass. Does the electron actually have mass? Well, yes, it does. I own 7, probably a little bit more now. I own 7 tons of property. I know this because I hired movers to move it. And the way they charge is based on weight. So they will take their truck and they will weigh it when it's empty. And then they will load you up and weigh it again when it's laden, when it's full. And they will tell you how much your stuff weighs. Well, when they went to weigh their truck, and they came back, and I saw the trucker get out of the cab. I saw him do this. He picked up a gum wrapper out of his cab and threw it away. That gum wrapper changed the weight of that rig. Did I complain? You suppose I complained?
Heavens, no.
Why not? Gum wrapper has weight, has mass.
It wasn't enough.
It was not significant relative to the mass of the truck. The electron is the same way. Does it have mass? Yes. Compared to the mass of the electron, the mass of the electron is insignificant. So when we say electrons have no mass, what we really mean is that it's not significant. Now, the electron was expected. You find the proton, there has to be a negatively charged particle. There has to be. They may have been surprised by the mass. There has to be. It has to be there. But the weird thing is, this is just, this blew their mind, was that there was a mystery being that was not affected. By the plates. If it's not affected by the plates, it has no charge. That blew them away. They did not expect that. It was an unknown beam. It was a mystery beam. It was a ray that can't be explained. It was a ray that was algebraically. What letter algebraically do we often assign to an unknown?
N.
It's a good guess. Usually we use X, don't we?
Yeah.
X marks the spot. They didn't know what this was. This was their X-ray. It was a ray that they did not understand. It was heavy. It had no charge. It weighed as much as the proton. It was the same weight as the proton to within. It was heavy. It had no weight. They called this the neutron because it was neutral. The symbol N01. No charge, but a mass equal to that of a proton. So we can make a little table. So the proton is heavy. Oh, I'm sorry. It has a mass of plus one and a mass, not a Mars, a mass that they called one. When we talk about elements, you know what? I think I'm putting that on the wrong side. Let me look something up here real quick, because I'm putting that on the wrong side. And that's a massive brain fart. Should be the upper right-hand corner, not the lower left. So I apologize to you. Those masses belong up here, not down below. There are four quadrants around an element. Four quadrants. We saw that the lower right-hand side is for the number. So if you have some element fluorine, this lower left-hand side is for the number in the compound. Upper right-hand side is for the charge. Elements with a charge are called ions. We'll talk about those a little bit later, but you always put the charge in the upper right-hand corner. The upper left-hand corner is for the atomic mass. Usually you don't have to write the atomic mass. But even more rarely, you usually do not have to write the atomic number. And I know we have not discussed these yet. We will. If you know the element, you do not need the atomic number. And I'll show you why sometimes we are going to write it down. Usually we won't. So I apologize for my faux pas. Putting that mass in the wrong location. So the electron has a mass, a charge of negative one, and the mass of the electron we take to be zero. Give ourselves just a little more room here. And we have our neutron, sometimes called Jimmy. Kidding, that's a cartoon. The neutron has a charge of zero, but a mass equal to that of the proton. N10. Now, knowing the three atomic, subatomic particles, and yes, these particles can be broken down further. High energy physicists have broken these down and discovered all kinds of subatomic particles, quarks and leptons and muons and gluons and... We're not going to, that's well beyond the scope of this course. We are going to focus on these three particles. But knowing they exist is a little bit different than understanding how they are put together. Originally, scientists believed that something that they called the plum pudding model. And yes, that was what it was called. They knew the approximate volume of an atom. Once they figured out how many atoms are in a mole, you take a mass, you measure its volume, divide by the number of atoms, you get the average volume of an atom. It's not hard. And they believed that basically the protons and the neutrons made up like the background, like the pudding part. This is big gamush of protons and neutrons, and that's what most of it is because we know they're heavier, they must be bigger. And then you have electrons embedded in this pudding, kind of like plums, which used to be synonymous with raisin, by the way. Sometimes it's called the raisin pudding model. We're going to take a 5-minute break. When we come back, we're going to talk about Rutherford, who proved, see, I told you, you can never prove a theory, but you can disprove it. We're going to talk about a failed experiment that proved the plum pudding model is wrong. So let's take 5 minutes, please. We will reconvene at 10:50. Does that sound fair?
Sounds good.
All right. And welcome back. In science, you can't prove anything is true. You can only disprove things. And I've said it before and I'll say it again. All we teach are models that best represent, best encompasses all available experimental data. It's all it is. Is it truth? We think it is. We hope it is. We know it might not be. But we can disprove. Here is probably one of the most famous failed experiments in history. Someone named Rutherford did a very similar experiment. He started off with a source of radiation in a lead block. And he put his lens system in there to focus the radiation beam. Now, we have a phosphor screen on the far end, but sometimes instead of charged plates, they would put different objects in the path to see what radiation would pass through, what it would not. He used an extremely thin gold foil. Piece of gold foil that he passed the radiation through. The atomic symbol for gold is AU. It's called AU. The reason we go with the symbol AU is because that comes from AU, come back here with my gold. Now he knew that the radiation was going to pass through the gold foil, and it did. But he did something very, very strange. He messed up, because instead of putting a phosphorus screen here, he extended his phosphorus screen almost the entire way around the experimental apparatus. So his phosphorus screen encompassed the entire experimental apparatus. And he did. He got his bright spot right there, right where he expected it. But, and this is a big hairy but, he also got a spot here, and a spot here, and a spot here. Even got spots all the way back here. That thin gold foil that should not have stopped that radiation beam was deflecting it everywhere. His experiment failed, because he believed the plum pudding model was correct, just like everybody else. And the density of the atoms that they had calculated based on that size, there is no way those atoms should have been able to deflect radiation all around. He had a great quote. He said, "It was as if I shot a cannonball at a piece of tissue paper and it bounced straight back towards me." He knew that there had to be something in the atom that was extremely dense, something that was extremely packed that would deflect that radiation beam. We called that the nucleus. When you are enjoying a tender steak, tender piece of meat, and all of a sudden you get that one little bone in there, you don't expect that bone. Something very dense. It hurts, man. The model that Rutherford proposed for the atom is still the one that we use today. A little bit simplistic, but he suggested a very dense core called the nucleus. And the nucleus, he said, contains all of the protons and all of the neutrons. The electrons make up the rest of the volume. They're somewhere in orbit around the nucleus. This is the Rutherford atom. And it's how we view atoms today. So how do we identify atoms? You go back to Dalton's atomic theory. Atoms of the same element are indistinguishable. Atoms of different elements are distinguishable. How do we distinguish various atoms? Well, if you look at the Rutherford atom, when atoms interact, it's the electrons that interact. It's not the protons, it's not the neutrons. The protons and neutrons are protected by this sheath of electrons. When you touch something, you cannot actually touch it. When I'm picking up my Diet Coke, what's really happening here is that the electrons in the atoms of my skin are repelling, because remember, like charges repel, they are repelling the electrons in the plastic of the bottle. I'm not actually touching the bottle because the electrons are repelling each other. All touch is an illusion. It's just the atoms on one surface touching the atoms on the other. That means that chemistry is nothing more than the interaction of electrons. It's just the interaction of electrons. And in a neutral element, and we will discover that elements have charges. Elements that have charges are called ions. But in a neutral element, and every element that you have, if Kim, do you have any gold? Do you ever wear gold?
Yes.
Gold is an element. If it's in its elemental state, it's neutral. Have you ever written with a pencil?
Yes.
Pencil lead is made of carbon. It's neutral. And because it's neutral, the number of protons must be equal to the number of electrons. The charges must cancel out. This is how we identify elements, not by the number of electrons, because when elements react, those electrons are being exchanged. Sometimes they're shared, sometimes they're given away, sometimes they're accepted. The total number of electrons can change. So we do not identify elements by the number of electrons. We understand that if you have an element in its elemental form, only in its elemental form, it is not true if it's in a compound. If it's in its elemental form, the number of electrons equals the number of protons. But, and that's a big hairy but, the number of electrons can change. What cannot change is the number of protons. The number of protons is fixed because it's in the nucleus, and the nucleus is protected by the electrons. The number of protons will never, ever, 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 ever change, except except in nuclear reactions, which is beyond the scope of this course. So when unstable isotopes like radon fall apart, they form new elements. They form something different because the number of protons change. The number of protons is called the atomic number. The atomic number is the number of protons. And the atomic number, if we look at a periodic table, can I expand this? No, I cannot. I actually have a periodic table, but I don't have it on this particular system. I need to get it on here. So the atomic number, so in the periodic table, every element has a one or two letter designation. The ones that have three, UUT, UUP, UUS, those are new elements. Okay. When an element is discovered, it is given a temporary three letter designation until scientists at the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry, IUPAC, that is the governing body that decides on things like nomenclature. They decide on the names of elements, they decide all that kind of stuff. So until the IUPAC gets together and decides on a name for an element, didn't used to be like that. Then it's given a three-letter designation. Used to be that whoever discovered the element could name it. And sometimes they would name it after themselves. Sometimes they would name it after where it was discovered, like californium, which is, I believe, no, that's, there it is, californium, right down here. Can you see that little hand, the pointer? So yeah. Element number 98, that's californium that was discovered, guess where? University of California. Tungsten. Element number 74, the atomic symbol for tungsten is W. And you might say to yourself, how in the heck do you get tungsten from a W? Tungsten was discovered more or less simultaneously in Germany and in England. The English called it tungsten. The Germans called it wolfram. W-O-L-F-R-A-M, wolfram. They could not decide who discovered it first. They sued each other, and the decision was made. They're going to go with the English name, tungsten, but the German symbol, W. A lot of these letters, a lot of these symbols, come from ancient times, like ancient Rome. Ancient Rome used lead, which is here, element number 82. They called it plumbum because it's what they used in their plumbing systems. That's where plumbing comes from, plumbum. Nowadays we call it lead, but we maintain the Latin root, the Latin symbol, PB. As you look at the periodic chart, in most periodic charts, not all of them, you will see a number usually above the symbol of the element or just to the right. Just to the left. That is the atomic number. So the atomic number of hydrogen is 1, the atomic number of helium is 2, the atomic number of lithium is 3, and so on. This is why, if atomic theory, if this model of the atom is correct, this is how we know that we have discovered every element up to the last one. Can we discover heavier elements? Maybe, someday. They're not terribly practical. The new elements that they're discovering these days have lifespans of nanoseconds or even femtoseconds. It's not like it's going to be around long enough to make anything useful from it, which is why I personally don't follow the new element discoveries. It doesn't mean anything to me personally. They're important to physics because even if they exist for a fleeting moment, they can still get experimental data to verify other hypotheses of atomic theory. But I don't worry. I don't keep up with it. But this is why we know we've discovered every element. This is why we believe we've discovered every element. Between silver and cadmium, silver is element number 47. That's the atomic number. Cadmium is the atomic number 48. But the atomic number is also the number of protons in the nucleus. You cannot have, as far as we know, you cannot have a fraction of a proton. That's why we will never discover anything between silver and cadmium, because you can't have 47 and a half protons. You either have 47 protons or 48 protons and nowhere in between. This is why when I see movies, and they do this a lot, I have heard this line in so many movies, well, it's not an element from our planet. Oh my God. No, it can be an alloy that's not from our planet. Alloys are mixtures of metals. It could be an alloy. That's ridiculous. Okay. I wish I could zoom in here so you could see it bigger. But let's look down on, and I don't know why they're doing that. It used to be that they didn't do that, but they're doing it here. It drives me crazy. Maybe there's another one where we can see it. Here we go. Meitnerium. Let's look at meitnerium, element number 109. Now, if you have meitnerium, named after Meitner, who was a nuclear physicist, I believe. If I write down the two-letter symbol MT, that's meitnerium. Meitnerium always, 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 always has the atomic number 109. Or if I tell you it's an element with atomic number 109, it's always, 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 always meitnerium. That's how we identify it, by the number of protons. But sometimes you will write the atomic number down here. I don't know why. Actually, I do. But notice that iridium, right above meitnerium, there's a little number under iridium, 192.22. That is the atomic mass of iridium. And we'll talk about that. We'll do calculations with that. But some of these, not many, will have a number in a square bracket. So it's not 192.22, it's simply 278 in the square bracket. Notice so far that we've not mentioned neutrons. We know where they live in the nucleus, but we've not talked about them. They're not used to identify the element, but they have a mass. As it turns out, the number of neutrons usually has a little bit of flexibility. Meitnerium has some atoms with more neutrons. It has some atoms with fewer neutrons. The element is always identified by the number of protons. But if the number of neutrons changes, so different number of neutrons, how do I write this? The different number of neutrons will change the mass because remember, neutrons have a mass. So the different number of neutrons changes the mass, that changes the atom, which we call an isotope. When we talk about isotopes, we're talking about the same element, but with different masses, and therefore different number of neutrons. If you have a number in a square bracket like this, you have a different, you have a, the square bracket represents the most stable isotope. So up here, nickel, 58.7, that's the atomic mass. Meitnerium, 278, is the atomic mass number. We say atomic mass number because it is specific to one isotope and one isotope only. Now, the atomic number is the number of protons. The atomic mass number, remember, the two particles that have mass, protons and neutrons, and fortunately, they have the same mass. So the atomic mass number is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. So the atomic mass number identifies the isotope, but it is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. This is the only reason I can think to write down the atomic mass number. Because when you write the atomic mass number and the atomic number, I'm sorry, not the mass number, the number. When you write the atomic number in this way, notice it is lined up for subtraction. Number of protons plus neutrons minus the number of protons will give you what? The number of neutrons. So we subtract when you subtract the atomic number from the atomic mass number, that is the number of neutrons. Okay? And you can't see that because my remarkable, I'm using my remarkable and I should be doing this. So let me, I apologize for that. Let me show you my remarkable. Wow. Here we go. Sitting or doing it like you can. Oh, look, here it all is. Okay, so let's go through this real quick. The atomic symbol is meitnerium, MT. Let me use my little pointer here. Okay, so here's your atomic symbol. Meitnerium is always atomic number 109, which is down here. Okay, that's why usually we don't write the atomic number, because the atomic symbol identifies the atomic number. If you see something with an atomic mass number up here, that is one isotope of that element. One single isotope. It's a very specific isotope. If you subtract from the atomic mass number the atomic number, you see the number of neutrons. The atomic mass number is the number of protons plus neutrons. So meitnerium 278. Has 169 neutrons. So when you have a different number of neutrons, you have a different mass, which gives you a different isotope. We are going to continue this conversation at the start of lecture on Tuesday, but let me give you one more example, Kim, because I was talking about my remarkable while showing you the periodic chart. I'm going to give you a second here. Let me know when you're ready for me to move on.
We're good.
Okay. Moving on. Let me give you. There's only one element where we have specifically named isotopes. Hydrogen. And it has three isotopes. One of them is called hydrogen. The other one you may have heard of, deuterium. The third one you may or may not have heard of is tritium. These two are simply isotopes of hydrogen. And here's the difference. Hydrogen has an atomic mass number of one. In your book, if you have your handy dandy book with you, right in the front, you will see a periodic chart. This will help as reference if you open that up. You'll see that hydrogen is atomic number one, which means it has one proton. So for hydrogen, for the hydrogen isotope with a mass of one, how many neutrons does it have? Well, protons have a mass of one. Neutrons have a mass of one. We know the proton, it has one proton. Therefore, this has zero neutrons. Deuterium, I'm going to run just a minute over our class time here. Deuterium has atomic mass number of two. How many neutrons? Well, we know that because it's hydrogen, it has one proton, but its mass is two. Two minus one gives us one neutron. Tritium has an atomic mass number of 3. I'm sure you're seeing a pattern now. What is the number of neutrons? Okay, 2 neutrons.
Oh, am I supposed to answer?
Well, I was hoping you would, but that's okay. Notice in the periodic chart, it gives the atomic mass. Of 1.008. Where does that 0.008 come from? How do you have 0.008 protons or 0.008 neutrons? You don't. The atomic mass is the weighted average of all naturally occurring isotopes. In other words, if you take water and you put electrodes in it and you separate out the hydrogen, your hydrogen will be a mixture of hydrogen, deuterium, and tritium. All 3 isotopes will be present, and on average, its atomic mass will be 1.008. I apologize. I am 2 minutes late. Any questions before we wrap up?
We're good.
Okay. Thank you so much for your time. I'm sorry that I was late. We will continue this next week on Tuesday. Thank you very much. I hope you have a great day.
Bye.
Yep.